to a brand new episode of the podcast entitled Couch Potatoes Unite! Exclamation point. This is a podcast based on a blog of the same name because we don't want you to be blind to our identity. We don't want it to be a secret. I'm the blogger in question and the moderator of this podcast. My name is Kylie and I love TV. If you feel the same, keep listening and or checking out the blog at couchpotatoesunite.wordpress.com as you're bound to find some common ground or something you like. For at Couch Potatoes Unite, we're all about the wonders and the unique long-form storytelling of the small screen. CPU, exclamation point, is heating up big time. The 2015-2016 season has come to a close. We ended our calendar year on May 31st, wink wink, so we hope you've kept score on your favorite shows. We also hope you've been following releases of brand new episodes of the podcast on Wednesdays, as well as new blog entries on some Tuesdays. And as always, we have several more new episodes on the way. Because the panelists and I live lives behind our podcast, the episodes are still being published once per week in mini-seasons, kind of like The Walking Dead. So subscribe to the blog or the podcast via iTunes or Stitcher Radio to stay on top of brand new episodes. Episodes already published discuss a variety of shows, including, but not limited to, Game of Thrones, Orange is the New Black, Doctor Who, Downton Abbey, How to Get Away with Murder, Broadchurch, and The X-Files from its inception through its revival. We've taken a look back at True Blood, Ally McBeal, Futurama, and Desperate Housewives, and more episodes are in the works, including revisits for Once Upon a Time, Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., The Vampire Diaries, Gotham, and Unbreakable Kimmy Schmidt. Plus, our DC Television Universe panel will shortly be covering Arrow Seasons 3 and 4 and The Flash Seasons 1 and 2. We are also starting up new panels to discuss shows including New Girl, Supernatural, and American Horror Story, and we'll be taking one of our looks back at the popular, critically acclaimed HBO drama 6 Feet Under. If you don't hear your show in this podcast format, though, check out the blog. Fellow panelists and I still write reviews, and we're always seeking new panelists, so if you have any interest in joining the discussion, say hello. We have a Facebook page, a Twitter, follow us at CPU Podcast, and an email address at couchpotatoesunitepodcast@gmail.com. Now, we also have an Instagram at couchpotatoesunite and a Pinterest at CPU Podcast. Of course, you can always subscribe to the blog, our YouTube channel, our iTunes channel, or our Stitcher Radio channel and leave comments and reviews. A thumbs up on YouTube or a few handy words on iTunes would help us spread the word, so please consider taking a few seconds to do it. We would truly appreciate it. Today we are around the water cooler as a continuation of another brand new CPU exclamation point podcast series. This series won't have a fixed number of episodes like other series we do. Rather, it will be ongoing, given the fact that streaming service Netflix is creating various series with the aim of combining all of the protagonists into a crossover miniseries called The Defenders. With that said, welcome to the third episode of our Marvel's Defenders panel. In this series, we have already discussed Season 1 of Marvel's Daredevil and Season 1 of Marvel's Jessica Jones. Today, we're discussing Season 2 of Daredevil, which was released in its entirety to the Netflix streaming library on March 18, 2016, with a total of 13 episodes, which means, for the record, that the show is legally available to Netflix subscribers exclusively, as it is Netflix-produced original content. Created by Drew Goddard, Daredevil is based on the Marvel Comics character of the same name, is set in the Marvel Cinematic Universe, sharing continuity with films of the franchise, and is the first in a series of shows that will lead up to the Defenders crossover miniseries. Charlie Cox stars as Matt Murdock, aka Daredevil, a blind lawyer by day who fights crime at night. In the second season, Matt continues to balance life as a lawyer and as Daredevil while crossing paths with Frank Castle, aka The Punisher, played by Jon Bernthal, a vigilante with far deadlier methods, as well as the return of his old girlfriend, Elektra Nachios, played by Elodie Young, who tempts Matt with his past while seeking to manipulate his future, upsetting the balance that Matt seeks. In addition, his friend and law partner Foggy Nelson, played by Eldon Hansen, questions his choices, which invariably affect Matt's friends as well as his tentative romance with assistant Karen Page, played by Deborah Ann Wall. Today, in the third episode of our Marvel's Defenders series, we will be focusing specifically upon Daredevil Season 2 with our Defenders panel, all of whom should be familiar to anyone who has listened to previous chapters in this series. This includes Kyle, Hilary, Spencer, Nick, and Kristen. Because I think all are ready and raring to get to the discussion, I want to remind listeners that all of our panelists have viewed all of Daredevil to date and may discuss sensitive plot points. So, for those of you who haven't watched Daredevil, including prior seasons, and possibly including the first season of Jessica Jones, and plan to do so, listen at your own risk, as there will, as always, be major spoilers. At this time, I'm going to reintroduce our panel by taking their temperature with the CPU exclamation point standard character question that changes with each show we do. After all, an interest in a show may wax or wane from season to season, and there is a wide range of, let's face it, fairly strong opinions on this panel, so we need to see where all of them are nowadays with respect to how they are feeling about Daredevil. Are you ready for this panel?
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
Ready to go.
All right. Well, welcome back. Let me ask you how you feel about Daredevil now that you've watched season two. Did you watch it because you're fascinated by all vigilantes, even the anti-hero kind, and you believe in their ideals and sense of justice? In fact, you probably fight for truth and justice on your own time, too, like Karen Page. Did you watch it because your best friend is allegedly blind, and you're fighting to keep a normal life while protecting your blind friend's vigilante secret identity, even though you don't really want to, and or don't really want to watch this show, and or don't agree with your friend's life choices, like Foggy Nelson? Did you watch it because you're in prison? What else do you have to do? Manipulate the system and rule the roost with your unparalleled leadership charisma, like Wilson Fisk, a.k.a. Kingpin? Did you watch it because you want to ensure that bad people get what's coming to them, even if you have to dole out the punishment yourself, like Frank Castle, a.k.a. The Punisher? Did you watch it because you thought it was a good story based on more than a kernel of truth, and you were ultimately after a good story that ultimately tells the truth, like Mitchell Ellison, who's the newspaper editor of the paper that Ben worked for? Did you watch it because you get a thrill from all the violence for reasons unexplained, though you obviously like to walk on the wild side, like Elektra Nagios? Now, I don't expect you to pick the next three, although somebody probably will try to pick the last one. You didn't watch it or didn't finish watching it because you couldn't take all the violence, like Claire Temple, a.k.a. the Night Nurse. You didn't watch it because you think vigilantism is wrong and prevents the cops from doing their jobs and maintaining respect in order to maintain law and order, like Sergeant Brent Mahoney. Or you didn't want it or want to watch it because you are too concerned about your nighttime pursuits as a vigilante, concerned for justice and the safety of your city, plus you're technically blind, like Matt Murdock, a.k.a. Daredevil. And as I told the panel, if you listen to our last Daredevil podcast, get over it, he can't watch TV! Okay, continue.
I'm still going to say you're putting him in a box. Blind people can watch TV too, they just can't see the picture.
But I know he wants to watch it. He's too busy.
He cares about his city. He says it many times.
So he's out there fighting and not watching TV.
Okay, you just don't want us to pick Daredevil. But anyways, with that being said, I'll just go first. I'm Hilary, and I, in terms of the context of these selections and your funny little descriptions, I'm going to say that I am mostly Karen Page, definitely, this season. She's not necessarily my favorite character, but based on your description, yeah, I'm pretty just, at this point, I'm so stoked about watching this show further and all of the characters, and it helps having my never-ending comic book guy with me while I watch it.
So, remind the listeners.
Standard disclosure.
If you've been listening to our Defenders series, or really many of our other podcast series and or episodes, Hilary is my sister. Kyle, who will most likely go next, is her husband. And they are here together.
Yes, we are here together, and he is my comic book guide. And so it's really fun to watch it, so I just get really excited about it, and I just really loved the extra additions this season. I thought it brought it to a whole other level.
All right, welcome back, Hilary.
And I'm Kyle, Hilary's husband. In terms of the characters, I'd say I'm a blend between Karen and the Punisher. Okay. I watch it because I obviously support Daredevil, and I'm fascinated by him. And also for the violence.
He loves the Punisher as much as he loves Daredevil.
My two favorite superheroes are Daredevil, Punisher, and then Captain America. So,
oh, okay.
For the season of Daredevil.
Yeah, you say sorry. He's just really excited.
It's fine.
He's just really excited about it.
Yeah.
He's waited his whole life for this.
But you said you love the violence. Wouldn't that also make you Elektra?
Kind of. Yeah. Based on your description.
I thought it too. I go with Frank Castle.
All right. Well, welcome back, Kyle.
I'm Spencer, and I'm also going to go with Karen Page on this. That description suits this series very well. Although the fight scenes, as fantastic as they are, do put a couple of drops of Punisher into me as well.
Yeah.
The fight scenes and the fight choreography are just brilliant in this show, and that was part of the reason why I enjoyed season one so much, and season two didn't disappoint in that department either.
Okay. Welcome back, Spencer.
I'm Nick, and I'd like to be the junkie from Jessica Jones.
That is not an option. He didn't cross over this season.
Not yet. Not yet.
When he does, you can.
Then probably the editor, I think.
Okay.
See, you wouldn't let me pick Daredevil. He's jumping shows.
Even closer.
So, let me see. You watched it because you thought it was a good story based on more than a kernel of truth?
Yeah.
Welcome back, I think, Nick.
Hi, I'm Kristen. I don't know how to follow that.
You should just do it.
I'm Kristen. I'm the one who notoriously hated Daredevil season one and loved everything about Jessica Jones. I am happy to report that I have been converted.
Yay! You're the joke.
I will neither confirm nor deny. So I would say, in light of Kylie's fabulous character descriptions, I am a combination of Karen Page, because I am fascinated by all of the Marvel Universe, with a little bit of a change there, but I am also the newspaper editor, Mitchell Ellison, because I think it's a really good story. Finally. It's finally a really good story.
Oh, wow.
And I could not stop watching.
She's going down the chair.
Like I said, I have been converted since I have, you know, now watched them in the correct order.
I was going to ask about this correct order, though. The chronology, where does this take place in the timeline in comparison to Jessica Jones? Is it afterwards?
It's afterwards. Like,
okay.
It's definitely after. Doesn't come up much, though. I just rewatched season two yesterday. I finished it. But Claire mentions...
I rewatched it as well.
Jerry Hogarth.
That's, that was what I was going to
Jerry Hogarth, yeah.
There are surgeons of superpowered people.
I mean, obviously, because I saw the last three episodes in the last 24 hours... With Hogarth, she didn't have any scars visible, which surprised me, and that's why I was asking about the chronology, because she should have plenty of scars from...
Unless she has a very good plastic surgeon.
Which is possible.
Or maybe she's meta.
Or she's an alien.
Or maybe she's
Or the continuity department overlooked it.
Yeah. Or it's not immediately after Jessica Jones.
Yeah, it could have been a little while.
I would say the timeline, I think, like, maybe a month.
I would say so.
Yeah.
There's time to heal. I think there was time to heal.
Yeah.
Okay.
But it's just hard.
Before we get too far into it, I will just mention that, like the last time, I think I would also be Karen Page because of all the things I said. I'm fascinated by all the vigilantes, including the anti-hero kind this time.
Yeah.
I can't wait to talk about the Punisher.
Oh, yeah.
So... That being said, let's talk about season two. Chronology aside, start telling us, what'd you think about it? What'd you like, what you didn't like? And what did you think of the two big new introductions this season? Obviously, the Punisher, and then Elektra.
I was impressed with how they were able to weave all these new characters in. Like, that they could bring William Fisk back. I don't know if that's his first name.
Wilson.
Wilson.
Yes. William.
William the first of Hell's Kitchen. Yeah. No, just kidding.
Now I'm confused.
Wilson the Conqueror.
There we go.
Spencer got it.
Not less confused. I like how they didn't just bring the Punisher in, then he was done, and then they brought Fisk back at the end, then we have some side stories with Elektra. It's all kind of tying together.
Beautifully woven together.
Yes,
yeah.
That, I think, has to be my favorite part, because it makes all those other parts that I really like stand out even more, and they're stronger, so that's my favorite.
Yeah, I'll agree with Nick. I thought season one of Daredevil was painfully slow, and it was a chore to watch, and I feel like season two, they found their pacing, and they were able to have the three, you know, big characters and the storylines all going on simultaneously, and that's not something that a lot of shows do well. A lot of shows try, but they don't accomplish it, and from a storytelling perspective, since I am the newspaper editor, that was something that I really appreciated.
I also agree that the pacing was much improved and was near flawless this time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
I'll agree.
There was a couple of...
It started slowly for
it
me.
It started slowly.
It took the introduction of Wilson Fisk, the whole... When the prison scene started up, for me to really get electrified
scene.
By...
That was good.
Once Wilson Fisk appeared, I was hungry to watch every other episode, but until then it was a little slow for me.
I agree that it started slow, but I felt hungrier the first time the Punisher appeared.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I think they wanted that slow build to him, not just like him showing up in full action.
For sure. And John Bernthal was so amazing.
Yes.
This character. And he's probably not going to get an Emmy nod because it's a superhero show and that's just how they work at the Emmys. But he deserves it.
Oh,
this
wait,
time.
That monologue in the cemetery.
Oh, amazing. That's amazing.
Yes.
And the progression of his character and the building of his character from beginning to end and seeing him going from just being a crazy vigilante to a vigilante with a purpose by the end of the series was fantastic. Mm-hmm. It was so well done.
And looking at him through each of the characters' different perspectives also it was kind of unique the way they told his story, because it wasn't him necessarily telling his story, but for that scene in the graveyard. Everybody else was telling his story just by analyzing how
his
do
action.
I agree with this man?
Yeah.
How do I agree with what he's doing?
How do I take him on?
Right.
Yeah.
Really, it's the first time the Punisher's been... Everyone talks about how he's been done justice and how he acts and like his actions and his fighting, but really his character too, and in the world, how the world sees him. Because like that's the biggest kind of like problem in the Marvel Universe, is the ones that support him and his interactions with other superheroes. Because other superheroes don't consider him a hero or anything. They consider him a serial killer. And so that's why I always loved him, because him and his friendship with Daredevil is the most different and unique partnership in comic book history.
Well, they're two sides of a very fine line.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. With regard to the telling of his story, I thought the way it was shown through Karen's eyes was the most important part of how it was told, because it gave you some sympathy for him. Without her look at it, he would have been a harsher character. Mm-hmm.
Well, especially too when they showed her going to his house that he had
essentially,
since he'd abandoned since the death of his family, and seeing her reaction to seeing the children's toys and the medals on the wall, and seeing how proud his family was of him and how much they loved him, that was a huge turning point.
Yeah, and like honestly, one of my favorite scenes is when they end up in that diner, and they and Frank and Karen have that whole conversation, and he's talking about, you know, he basically calls her out on being in love with Matt, and the, you know, the pain that you feel from that, and you're kind of complaining about it, but I would give anything to have that back. Like just right that right there. I mean, he just nailed it. And, you know, listening to him, Kyle, for years, talk about the Punisher, because it is one of his favorite characters, he actually had me read a couple issues in the past, and I just really think John Bernthal, he nailed it.
Yeah,
I don't think...
The writers nailed it, too.
Yeah, the writers did nail it, too. Like, you know, obviously we've seen John Bernthal in other things. He was obviously big on The Walking Dead, but to me this is, like, one of his, for sure, standout performances, easily. If not,
again, it
the
comes
biggest.
Down to good casting, doesn't it?
It
does. They did a really good job of casting this show.
Mm-hmm. I mean, if you look at it, they weren't going to do a Punisher series until they started. They were getting dailies back of him. I think they said it was by the time, like, the episode with Fisk, where he went the whole prison fight and that. Then they realized, like, yeah, he needs his own show. He's not a side character.
So that's confirmed. That was going to be my next question.
Oh, yeah, so
that is
confirmed
now.
Like, yeah.
He's, yeah, and he said that because we just went to Comic-Con in May, and he was there.
And Foggy.
And, yeah, and Eldon Henson, who plays Foggy, and they talked about that it's going to definitely expand. And his experiences, like, getting into the character, he said he had to go to some dark places, but it was worth it because so many people react. I mean, he literally came out into the room and was taking pictures of how full it was because he couldn't believe how much people reacted to it.
And he actually, like, he hunted down, like, he wanted that part so bad, and that's what set him apart, because everyone else was just pretty much coming in auditioning as just a guy
carrying
lots of guns.
Yeah,
like an action hero, like, you know, John McClane, like Die Hard style person, and he came in as a broken, he's doing it as a broken vet who just, like, he can't get out of that the war zone.
The Punisher has had a couple of prior film treatments, and that's typically how he's been portrayed as more of the Bruce, I don't even think, and as in-depth as,
yeah, like
what's
one,
his name?
Like one-liner action heroes,
yeah,
which is not
pretty much
what the Punisher is
right
at all.
So I appreciated the emotional depth, certainly, with this character, and I loved the conversations that, not just the graveyard, but every time him and Matt interacted, and it wasn't always animosity between them. There was some real meeting of the minds at times. They just kept their distance where their philosophy divided. And it was, I just felt he electrified the screen. And there was a couple of things that, I mean, we've mentioned the pacing, but I felt like the direction was really better. There was some really awesome shots that I noticed. And if I'm noticing shots, it's because the whole package is there.
Yeah, it's standing out.
Yeah. So for like the one that comes to mind is when they walk them into the courtroom for the trial for the very first time, and he's shackled and he's got the guards, and it's the last shot of an episode. I want to say it's maybe the fifth or the sixth one, and he's standing there, and it's in front of the American flag, and it focuses on him, and then the American flag comes into sharp view with his face in front of it, and then it cuts to black. And I was like, wow, that was really good.
Hits you.
The episode where they're on the rooftop and Daredevil's chained that chimney, like, if you took panels from that, because those are my favorite issues of all time, and when you take the panels of the comic book and look at the screen captures, they are dead on.
Nice.
Like, lighting and everything. It's like, I can't
they
even imagine
the
set
from
work
the material
that went into that.
That does seem to be something that Marvel is doing very well. They're hitting for the comic book fans, but they're also hitting for people like myself, who I was always a DC guy, but these Marvel shows are excellent and I'm enjoying them. So I don't really have the point of reference that you do, but I'm able to enjoy it in the same way.
Yeah, that's what's amazing about it. Like, comic fans will be like, oh my god, that is the issue I love, but it's so accessible and beautiful that you don't need
it. It is
that
accessible.
Yeah.
That's
yeah
a really good word to use. I mean, that's just it. I mean, even their relationship is so important. Like, Daredevil and Punisher's relationship is so important, especially from everything he's talked about. And I think, like you were saying, they did a really good job of showing their interaction in many different ways. I mean, you wouldn't think that's something that would translate really well, but it definitely did.
I loved it when they had the conversation where Daredevil said, okay, we're going to do it your way this time. And Franks says to him, no, because if you come to my way, you'll never
it's
be
not
the same.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
That
and
was
he respects,
so poignant.
The thing is that he respects him, right? I mean, am I right?
Yeah, they respect each other. I mean, like,
by the end, you see the mutual
respect. Like, Punisher only
yeah
respects certain people,
yeah,
right?
In the comics, Matt Murdock is the only person out of the superhero set that he respects. I mean, there's a point where Matt essentially does become Punisher. He reveals his identity and just starts going really hard on people. And he gets arrested and put in prison. And the Punisher gets himself arrested just so he can go in there and kind of be like, what the hell are you doing? Like, you're not me.
Yeah.
And they already started to build that, and it was amazing.
Yeah, it was really well done. This was... I really enjoyed season one, and this was far superior to season one.
I agree.
It was way superior to season one, from my perspective. But a lot of... I've been talking about this with some coworkers who are also fans of this, and one thing I keep saying, it's very hard when a first season is so well received, it's very hard to follow it up with a really good second season.
Exactly.
And I really think Daredevil is one of the few shows out there where the second season is better than the first, at least in my opinion.
Oh, for sure.
I agree with that.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I think it's far surpassed in many ways the first season. The first season was good. We all liked it better than you did. But the second season is so much better.
Mm-hmm.
So everybody liked The Punisher, yes?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
And real quick, their chemistry together was incredible.
Yeah.
I almost liked watching, you know, Daredevil and The Punisher on screen together more than I did Daredevil and Elektra on screen together.
That was a lovely segue.
Thank you.
Let's talk about Elektra. What did we think of her?
See, as a comic book fan, which is always my point of reference, it was a really good portrayal because you're not supposed to like Elektra in the comics.
She's in
pop culture, like in cartoons and other movies, they make her out to be like a superhero, fun, But she's really not supposed to be likable. She's kind of a train wreck. She ruins almost everybody she touches.
Well, that came through pretty clear.
They nailed that.
Yeah, they nailed that. I found her tedious because, as I was earlier saying, and I've said to a couple people, she's portrayed here as a sociopathic spoiled brat. And it was really hard for me to find any inkling of why Matt would have ever been interested in her, even at the time. We didn't get any backstory to the point at which he met her, so this was a weak point in the season, because I feel like...
Where was
at the party.
But didn't stick orchestrate that
she
did
stick
him.
To
yeah,
the orchestrate
you,
that.
But you didn't really get the chemistry that they had. There was no backstory to that chemistry.
Right.
Yeah.
What I'm saying is not the backstory itself. Like, we got eventually the backstory of how and why they met.
Yeah.
But why would Matt have, at the time, been like, oh, hey, let's...
She seduced him, basically.
I can fill you in on that.
Yeah, she did seduce him.
There's a change in their interpretation of his origins is actually kind of muddled that. But in the comics, his dad is killed when he's in college.
Mm-hmm.
And he meets Elektra the same week, and so he kind of wants to give up on his lawyer and his wife. And
let's just be honest, everybody has that situation at least once in their life that is a little crazy and you kind of regret.
Well, I also think he was able to be himself around her with fighting and not having to pretend that he can't get around as well.
Yeah, that's
well,
a good
she
point.
Also sort of forced that.
Yeah, I mean, that was like,
I know, you're Daredevil.
Yeah.
What did you think of the casting of the actress that played her?
I was a little concerned.
They hired her because she could do the martial arts.
Yeah.
She did the martial arts.
She did it very well.
This was the problem I had. Elektra's supposed to be Greek.
I was thinking the same thing.
She sounded like she was from halfway between New Zealand and Australia, and it just kept grating on me.
She's French. The actual actress is French, which kind of...
Yeah, she's like half Asian.
Half French. And I'm like, but she's supposed to be Greek.
She looked good on the screen, and her fight sequences were good. Her character development wasn't bad. It was just the accent just kept bothering me.
Yeah. her chemistry with Charlie Cox was really good. Like, they had...
It was,
But that could have just been because he's amazing.
He is
also true. I've liked him in pretty much everything he's done.
Yes.
There were a few scenes this season, though, where I didn't believe he was blind when he was interacting with people. It's like, he would turn and make eye contact, and a lot of the rest of the time, even when his eyes would be kind of vacant.
Mm-hmm.
But there were a few scenes this season where that kind of disappeared a little bit.
Ironically, though, he just gave an interview that was put out to press in the last week that said he lost the role as young Harrison Ford in the Han Solo spinoff and the Star Wars spinoff, because he's so used to looking off to the side and not making eye contact.
Interesting.
So he's screwing himself
up.
So
he's screwing up the audition by not making eye contact.
It's okay, Charlie. I still love
you. I love you much.
He's fantastic as Daredevil. I've not got a problem with him overall.
Oh, yeah.
If only we could see Charlie and David Tennant on screen in their Marvel characters, I think that would be pretty cool.
Are you seeding the Defenders crossover here?
Well, not yet. That's
okay.
Coming. But since we were talking about Charlie Cox and we all love David Tennant, I figured I just wanted to make my opinion known.
I see. Has been stated.
Yes. The opposite of a segue.
Is it though, or is it a non sequitur?
Ooh, that's a $5 word right there.
She just threw down
somebody's
something.
Somebody's going to
be
like,
"Damn!" So, what about some of the other plot points of season 2 of Daredevil, other than Punisher or Elektra, or inclusive of them as characters?
I liked Karen's transition from office assistant to journalist.
Yeah.
You did? Oh, okay.
I did.
She's really good at any type of job. She could be. She's basically like, you should be a lawyer. You're the best clerk
it's
I've ever
because,
had. Oh, you're a reporter.
Well,
write this paper. 2,000 words. I could write.
Okay, but in reality...
Saying it's a little far-fetched, Nick?
A little bit. It's funny
enough,
weird though. When that feels more far-fetched than all the superheroes.
Okay. So,
but I actually don't see the transition between journalist and lawyer being that far apart.
It's not, because the point...
But she wasn't a lawyer either.
What was she before? She was an office assistant. However, when you're working in an environment,
she
as
basically
an assistant, you're going to
research and investigate.
You're a researcher. You have to ask the right questions. You have to prep the case. You have to look for the facts.
And that's exactly
and
what
she's also
do.
Really invested, obviously, in her good buddy Foggy and her would-be love interest Matt. So of course she's going to jump on that
boat. I just
boat.
Feel like if I worked for the bullet, I'd be like, why does she have an office? How come I don't have an office?
Yeah, because you are the
you would say that, wouldn't you, Nick?
Why who else was using the office? She got Ben's old
somebody
office.
Somebody should have used it.
That's on the editor, not on Karen.
Yeah, but there was still a post-it note with her name on it.
On the folder.
Yes. It
quick
was
question.
Meant for her name.
What was
it
the
meant
folder?
For her, or was it his file of stuff he dug up on her?
That's what
that
I...
Was her, that was the files that were dug up on
it
her.
It was. I'm just okay. kind of kidding.
So what... quick question. Hey, non-comic book reader has a question.
Okay.
What was in the file? I didn't quite understand that. I know
it's
it was something...
her backstory, why she left her family and came to New York with no friends or anything.
Okay, have we seen that backstory?
No.
So maybe
it's something they're not filling.
It's been
yeah.
so maybe season 3 we'll finally get Karen's backstory.
Because Karen does have a much darker side, which I think they're going to go.
Thank you.
She
I was
a human.
Yeah,
but
I
even before that, like
there's a few
nice little tidbits in this season that open up for season 3, like at the towards the end where Punisher takes that disc out from behind the photograph.
Yeah.
Yes.
What is that?
What
is
that?
I have to wait till
next year.
You know
about time.
Well, Microchip is his sidekick. It's his tech guy and his files and hacking the computers and helping him get his guns.
Okay.
Which we saw some of. Did we see some of that with the Punisher character in Blade? In one of the Blade films where Punisher shows up? Or am I crossing over to something?
I think you're crossing over. In Warzone, Microchip was a character. A really bad Punisher movie.
Yeah, that was a terrible movie.
Is that the one like Thomas Jane back in the day?
No,
that was after that.
Yeah.
It was even worse. It wasn't...
Yeah.
Very few people back
See, because Kyle loves the Punisher so much, he made me see that movie in the theater.
It was not good.
So are the Punisher movies better or worse than the Daredevil movie?
Worse.
Really? Worse?
That's possible.
I would say worse.
Worse than the
Daredevil film? Yeah. Because I feel like with
those
movies,
I've got to see this
now. Miss the point. They completely miss the point of the Punisher. Whereas the Daredevil movie is just a very 90s, late 90s version. Like,
yes, it's like the George Clooney Batman.
Yes!
That's what I'm saying. Like, it's following
like
the 90s
like the
Batman
George
template.
Batman.
Yeah, it's like the George Clooney Batman.
Did anyone else just hear that?
No, what did she say?
She just said, I like the George Clooney
Kristen.
Kristen!
But it's so bad, it's good.
No!
Yes!
It's just bad. You can laugh at it. You can look at it like a comedy, maybe.
I just like it. I like what I like. Shut up.
She's not on the Gotham.
There's a big reason that I'm not in the DC.
I was so pleased this season, jumping back onto this, to see Wilson Fisk.
Yes!
And to see the way he manipulated that entire
so good.
It was brilliant.
It was such brilliant storytelling. And he is fantastic as that character.
I have to say that the scenes between him and Punisher were
so
the best
good.
Of the entire
I agree.
Yeah.
I was going to say that episode barely has Matt in it.
But it's
phenomenal. It was one of my favorites.
At least within the top three, if not, I mean, it could contend for my favorite episode of the season.
Yeah.
And him fighting all those guys and killing them, because the Punisher isn't just guns. Like, his almost superpower is that he is a survivor. No matter what happens to him, he keeps going. Like,
yes, his superpower is the Grim Reaper.
Yeah.
The skull.
Yeah.
And that was beautiful, too.
That was
organic,
which I liked.
That lovely, with the house exploding behind him, the imagery there, where you got to see the Punisher mask on his shirt. It was that was tasty.
And I liked that costume, it's not straight from the comic books, like it's not a big cartoonish skull.
That wasn't cartoonish
at
all.
No, yeah. I liked that it was kind of
like he painted
half-tone.
That.
It was like a little spray paint, so it wasn't totally bright white. It was kind of
like dripping, like dried drips down the...
The costume choices that they've made to not only pay homage to the original comic book design, but make that more believable in a real world type of
setting. Well, even Elektra's, because,
awesome.
I mean,
she's
she's pretty scantily clad in her animated versions, but they really made it they still incorporated the red and everything, but they really brought out the
ninja. They made it practical.
They made it practical!
Quick question. Was there a reason why Elektra's costume in this particular show, it was black with the red, but then also the ninjas, the members of the Hand, were also in the same color scheme. They looked very similar to me at certain points.
So should we segue into the whole Hand versus Chase Black Sky motif? Do you want to give us You'd be better at explaining it. This is the part where I got confused, so you'd be better at explaining it.
Yes, that's actually like something I was kind of curious as to how everybody who doesn't read the comics felt about the supernatural stuff being, because the hand is very supernatural. They're all undead.
Well, set us up for it.
Which they did show us that.
They did, that's what I'm saying.
They
said it. Their whole goal is they're resurrecting a demon. They think they need Elektra as its vessel, but really it's Matt. And that's why Stick's so protective. Which is this huge comic storyline called Shadowland, which is what they're building up to.
Okay. Black Sky, though, is the code word for the vessel.
But yeah, for people. Okay. And there's really only one person that's compatible with it, and they've been trying to find it for centuries.
And the zombies, how do they fit into the whole scheme of everything?
The five patients that...
pretty much every member of the hand can be resurrected. Like, they're resurrected after their first...
So that was not clear.
But why were the patients now working for, like,
brainwashed? I mean...
Yeah.
They did make
The hand has, like... Because they live for centuries, they have, like, encyclopedic knowledge of all kinds of mysticism. Which is really why, we brought up the Doctor Strange... being part of the Netflix series, I really thought they would tie that to this, because he fits perfectly with the hand and all of that.
They did sort of show the resurrection thing with Nobu.
Yeah.
Yes.
When he fell off the building at the end, and then suddenly woke up. I loved that when Stick, with Stick being there, too.
Yeah, he beheaded him, which was the ultimate, you're not coming back from this.
That was awesome.
Yeah.
I would assume they can do it.
After that, Nobu?
Yeah.
If you completely destroy them, then... Mm-hmm.
I would think fire could have completely destroyed them.
Mm-hmm. So I guess, kind of quick, going back to my question about do the costume colors have any significance?
Yes.
And then but it ties in, because at the very end, we see Elektra in that vessel in her lovely red silk gown, and she's now with the hand.
Essentially, in the comics, she's never been part of the chase. She's always been part of the hand. And for the longest time in the comics, she is the top. She is the leader of the hand.
Okay.
From the time she dies until... For all these years of the comics, she's been the leader of the hand. That's
so you think that's maybe coming in season 3 that she's going to be resurrected as the leader of the hand?
Yeah.
No? Okay. So maybe there is some color significance since it's black and red, and it's
that's why she's like stuck between.
Foreshadowing.
Daredevil is also.
He is, but just the way that her.
But I would also say that foreshadows the fact that
he
is the one they're looking for, just nobody knows it.
Yeah, and for me, I just saw more similarities in the style of her costume and the ninja's costumes. I felt like. They were very, very similar, more so than the Daredevil color scheme.
I just started to get very, to go back to your question, what did you think of it? I just started to get very confused when they introduced the backstory with Stick and training her. And I picked up that she was the one that they were kind of focused on, but maybe because there was a subtext there that Stick knows or theorizes that it may be Matt, really?
Yeah.
Okay. And I had to process that for a little while, because I was like, what really just happened there? And is Elektra going to come back to life because those zombie guys came?
I got a little confused with the backstory on her when they were showing the training, and there was the African-American guy, and I still have no idea who the hell he was.
Yeah.
Oh, those are members of the Chase. He took her when she was a kid,
right?
Started to train her, and then gave her to a foster family.
It was that one character that was like having discussions with Stick, like he was actually somebody significant, and then Stick killed him, and I'm like, well, what the hell just happened?
Yeah, because essentially they're underlings of Stick, but nobody kind of, he kind of puts on his big act where he's kind of in, you know.
They did kind of breeze over it, though.
Yeah.
Like, maybe they'll go more in depth. I think they're just trying to give taste of everything so that they can obviously build out the storyline even further.
I was going to say, yeah, because I have a feeling season 3 is going to be big. You'll see more of the Chase and their hierarchy, because it's not just Stick. There's somebody much older than him even leading that.
Oh, yeah. I definitely think they were telegraphing to the next season.
Yeah, so do we think the season 3 for Daredevil is going to come out before the Defenders crossover series?
Season 3 hasn't even yet been announced, so a release date has not been set for it.
Okay, because I was reading that the Defenders is coming out in 2017. They just haven't given a specific...
I think the next thing we get to see is Luke Cage in September.
They're trying to get Luke Cage and Iron Fist out before they get the Defenders out, because all four of them got to be in it.
Right.
And then the Punisher is probably going to be out before the Defenders miniseries.
Mm-hmm.
because of his popularity.
Yeah, they were really fast-tracking that one.
Yeah. Yeah, the Punisher is much... I would have been stunned if they hadn't have greenlit a Punisher after this, considering they're doing Luke Cage, which doesn't seem that interesting to me.
Yeah, Luke Cage, at least so far, didn't stand out as much...
as the Punisher
did. I know there's a lot of, loyal comic book fans that are excited for Luke Cage series, but I don't think that, overall, he stood out as much so far as the Punisher.
Mm-hmm. No. But we don't know what they'll do with his
character. Right, that's what I mean. But yeah.
I watched the trailer this afternoon that's on Netflix for it's about 20 seconds.
Oh, yeah.
It was a decent enough trailer, but it's just like that character so far hasn't really had much development at all, yet they've given him his own series already.
Well, but he has and he hasn't. He's a very understated character when he's introduced in Jessica Jones, so I think that's part of it. It wasn't really supposed to be about him. It was supposed to be about her. So he was more understated. Plus, he has a very subtle power, which is unbreakable skin.
Yeah.
So, however they're going to flesh that out, I don't know. But I have faith. They've done a good job.
They've done a good job so far.
I know as much about him, well, I guess a little more, than I did about the character Jessica Jones before I started watching that, and I liked it.
So yeah, exactly.
I'm not too worried.
I'm not too worried either. Karen was brought up earlier, and I just wanted to mention, number one, that they did have a couple of seeds about her past. She started to tell Matt about it when they went on the date at the Indian restaurant. We know she's from Vermont. We know she's got a younger brother. It's about all they've said so far. But also, did it bother anyone else? Because she kills Wesley in season one. Spoiler, if you haven't listened to our podcast or watched that season.
Then what are you doing listening to this one, you silly person?
Yes, exactly. Wesley was Fisk's assistant, his very loyal assistant, and had her pinned in an interrogation room, and she managed to kill him in the process of that. And yet we saw no aftermath of that at all. How do you feel about that? It bothered me, because it was like, knowing her character and knowing that action, that didn't add up.
Yeah, it feels like she should have been a little more bothered by it.
Yes.
Or at least affected in some way.
Though it could explain why she took to the Punisher.
Well, I would say that, because her whole confliction about the Punisher is, well, he's killing bad people, so maybe in some instances, killing is fine.
In fact,
it's better for the cities.
Yeah.
And that's what I think, just trying to look back and say, well, he was a horrible person, he was going to kill me, I made the city better.
It bothers me more the way they filmed that scene where she killed him. Like, if it was the one shot that killed him, but she shot him in the shoulder, I feel like she could have gotten away. She had the gun pointed to him, that she didn't necessarily need to kill him. Like, I feel like that should have weighed on her more. We should have seen some of that in the season, a little more than...
I don't know that I agree on that, because in that situation, if someone's taking you hostage and you feel fear for your life, even though you've gotten the upper hand on them, if they've done it once, and you know that they are related to a powerful organization that seems to be able to do anything, you would probably end them in that situation. Yes, you're going to feel remorse, maybe you'll struggle with the situation, but it's self-preservation.
I'm saying the way that it was shot, I'm not saying that the way it happened didn't make sense, or that she shouldn't have done it. I'm saying the way it happened should have affected her more than if the first bullet in that fear, I got the gun... killed him.
Yeah, I can see that.
Whereas there was bam in the shoulder, he was fine. There was a table between them. They were across the room. She, I think, was even closer to the door. And then she shot him two more times. I was fine with that until there was no, like, there was some. I could have not killed him. I could have maybe got more information out of him, too, like from a reporter.
I mean, she was so bothered by all the things that Fisk was doing in season one, to the point that she joined, Foggy and Matt on this side of the coin and chase them around and help that tenant in the slums and everything else, but then she actually takes a life. And that's exactly, I'm totally on board with Nick. For me, it didn't add up with her character as far as nothing. We got nothing. It does inform her relationship with Punisher, which is fine, and I get that, and I was totally okay with that, but it just seemed, oh, so that happened and we've forgotten about it. Now maybe it'll come back to haunt her. Right.
I would also say that after Fisk killed her mentor Ben, that then she probably would feel a little less bad about killing Fisk's right-hand man.
I I'm trying to remember.
Maybe you would.
I rewatched season one, and I can't remember her interactions with Wesley before that. Like, if to what extent she knew who he was.
I don't think she had many.
Yeah.
Wesley was a great character, too.
He was a great character.
Well acted, well written. Which is really the theme of this entire series, is it's well acted, it's well written. Best to be watched in a darkened room, however, because if you try and watch it when there's... Well, just to be able to see everything in detail on the screen. I had to close my blind at work today when watching one of the episodes.
It's a lot of night.
Yeah. And so it's really good to watch it in a dark room, because you catch all the detail on the screen.
Daredevil doesn't come out during the day.
No.
Lots of night.
Yeah.
So what do we think about some other plot points?
I don't have a plot point. I was wondering, sorry, when he's fighting at the I think it's the last episode on the rooftop, Daredevil, he doesn't have the mask on.
Nope.
And Punisher is shooting from the other roof. He didn't have a sniper scope or anything? Like, we don't think he saw his face.
I think he saw his face.
No, he doesn't. I would assume he saw his face, he just doesn't care.
He already said to him, I don't care who you are.
Yeah.
I mean,
plus, there was a moment in the trial when I thought,
he knows.
He knew. Because he was, you know, laid up in that hospital bed when Matt came in, when the three of them came in as his lawyers trying to represent him at first. And he was kind of out of it and not really focusing on it, but he perked up in the hospital. And then in the trial, I felt like there was another similar, and it was very subtle, but it was John's acting, where kind of the same expression happened when Matt started talking. So I feel like he knows.
Yeah.
They know each other. I mean, he made me read some, so I know they know each other as men.
On that point, did anybody else feel there was a bit of a Lois Lane moment in this season? Where Daredevil actually reveals himself to Karen, but like four scenes earlier, they're on the roof and he touches her face, and it's like, how do you not know?
Yeah.
Yeah, she's not always the best investigator.
Maybe that's Spider-Man. I was thinking, when that happened, I thought of a Spider-Man when, you know, she kisses him.
Yeah, the upside-down Mary Jane kiss. Yep.
Whatever, he wasn't upside down.
I don't know. I just feel like Karen should have put two and two together a long time ago.
Yeah.
Like,
usually that's my gripe
about
Karen.
It's like after Daredevil has a fight, Matt comes into the office all banged up.
Bang it up. And then you keep... You're like, what's going on, Matt? Like,
use your brain, honey.
Well, my other problem with that is... The other thing that helps that is that he's blind, so I could see her just... Well, yeah. But then she starts saying, instead of just drunk, joined a fight club. So you think he's fighting, so it's not that big of a leap anymore.
Well,
when she walked in on his apartment and there's a wounded Elektra and Stick sitting there like with his weapons and stuff, and she automatically just assumes, oh, he's cheating on me.
Yeah.
Not like, why is there weird ninja people here?
I actually did have a problem in that moment, too. Because... To assume cheating when there's also an old guy there. I mean, that's kind of a kinky scene.
Somebody's being on crazy.
Yeah,
I know.
Yeah, she was just wounded. She was very clearly wrapped up, and Matt's fully dressed, sitting on the side of the bed. Like,
so how did we feel about that reveal? Aside from the fact that Karen should have been less Lois Lane-like.
I wouldn't have minded it if it wasn't basically the second-to-last thing that...
We see.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I felt like he
was going to tell her a lot earlier.
I thought he was going to tell her, too. So I mean, because you could tell he was feeling the tension. He doesn't want to lose her, you can tell.
Yeah.
He loves her.
You know, of course, from also what I know from him, Daredevil is kind of like an accidental pimp. Like, he all the ladies love him. And you're already seeing that coming through.
Well, and also him telling her. He's a ladies' man. But the problem with Daredevil is anytime he gets close to somebody like that, it's pretty much like they're going to die. It's guaranteed.
So how do we feel about Foggy this season?
Better.
He finally got a backbone.
And you can see the weight that Matt puts on him. How he always has to clean up Matt's messes. And you can see why he's always on Matt's case.
Season one, he was a wet blanket. Season two, he was a developed character.
Yeah.
And it makes a huge difference.
Mm-hmm.
I still hate how he, like... There's a couple of moments where he was basically blaming Matt for, like, people like the Punisher existing. And I feel like,
That's a little much to put on one person.
Yeah. Like, this is going to happen. And then any other time he's like, you should stop doing this. Like, I hear people getting murdered. I can't not hear it.
I just think he's really hurt and he's afraid he's going to lose his... But I don't... You know, because, I mean, really, if it was your best friend and it was your reality, you would probably be pretty upset,
too.
Oh,
I just think he's stuck in their college days.
Jeez!
He doesn't want that to change. Like, he just wants them to
be he says that all the time. He's like, I want it to be you, me, and Karen, like, for always.
It's a common comic book device. The same thing happens in the Batman universe. Batman or Bruce gets blamed for the existence of all of these...
That's true.
Crazy, costumed, bad That's guys. It's just... Well, one won't exist without the other, and they use it. It's something we have to accept as comic book fans, is it's a device that they use to tell the story.
Well, that's what I kind of like about, Gotham. The villains are coming first, which is a little different. But
I agree, and I like that, too. Speaking of crossovers, there was a little trivia for you here. There is an actor that appeared in a DC show this season and a Marvel show this season. And he got demoted in the Marvel show. The guy who plays the Colonel in Daredevil, who was the Colonel...
Oh, yeah.
Clancy Brown. Yeah.
Clancy Brown was the General in the Grodd episodes and of Flash.
He's also the voice of Lex Luthor in, like, all the 90s cartoons. Like, he's actually a huge comic book fan.
And Mr. Krabs in SpongeBob SquarePants, I found out when Googling.
And the Kurgan in Highlander.
Yeah, Kurgan in Highlander.
And he's in Lost and Shawshank Redemption.
He got really sick as an actor, too, from the prosthetics they put on him in the film that meant that he didn't even want to put on any prosthetics when he played Kurgan in Highlander, which was another little bit of trivia I picked up about him when noticing he'd been on both shows.
I guess when I saw him, I thought, man, that guy is on everything that I didn't think specifically.
And
Flash.
He's evil.
Although, I would like to say, like, what is the coincidence that Frank's commanding officer is behind his random going to the park and his family being murdered? That was probably my only complaint about the plot, is that this whole thing was very coincidentally set up by your commanding officer. Like, what are the odds?
I was just going to say that I actually, even though I do understand Foggy, I've always understood Foggy, but I actually thought he was a tad bit whinier this season for the reasons that Nick said. Like, on the one hand, it affected his life a lot, and he had a right to be mad, but at the same time, Matt also kind of repeatedly says, I'm not going to change my mind.
The whiny worked for him this season, whereas in season one, it didn't really seem to ever have a catalyst. This season, there was plenty of reason for him to whine.
I guess he seemed a lot less like the ex-girlfriend.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah. Well, you know, it's now he's going to work with, you know, Hogarth.
Yes!
So. Yeah, that was a nice little crossover.
I like that. So, do you think he's going to appear in season two of Jessica Jones?
That would be
probably.
Because season two is greenlit, is that correct? Or not?
Yeah.
Season two is definitely greenlit and coming out this year.
Yes!
Or next year.
And she's going to add his name to the long list of
names.
I found that a little odd. After one trial to just throw him as a partner, right? That's what happened.
Well, they had two big trials because it was Fisk.
She's obsessed with, like, publicity. And that
because it was Fisk and the Punisher.
And Jerry's kind of trying to, like, rebuild the firm because she kind of screwed the pooch in Jessica Jones a little bit.
Oh, just a little.
Just a little bit. So she's probably looking for... Plus, he had a referral because his ex-girlfriend is a lawyer there.
Yeah.
So, to go back to the colonel, his commanding officer, he was the blacksmith, right?
Yes. He was the mastermind behind that huge drug trade got his brains getting killed.
I wanted to ask if the blacksmith was, like, a bigger character in the comics, because that was almost like a vigilante name, or
it's just pretty much
just
like
a code name.
Yeah, in, like, the Punisher's origins, it's just how he had to climb the ranks of criminals, and then eventually realize, because he originally planned, pretty much, I'm going to kill the people that killed my family, and then kill myself. And then as he did that, he started to see, in his own way, he can make the world better from his perspective if he just kept going.
That was a powerful scene in this season where the Colonel took Karen out to the car. She got in and that music was playing again, so she knew something was coming, but she had no idea what. And then the T-boning from the pickup truck, that was fantastic. They did so much well again.
They did.
Oh, and it was nice that Kingpin actually got the name Kingpin.
Yes.
I call myself Kingpin.
Yep.
What a great way to give yourself a nickname.
And they showed how lawyers can be evil.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Well, it just immediately, because the who was, I forget the real name of the guy that was at the prison who basically came in and told him, like, listen, you're not going to take my place here. And he just, he's like, okay.
Yeah, I don't remember. Yeah. He's dead now.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was, Irish game. Yeah, that was a really good, those few episodes were probably the highlight of the season for me. At least until the Punisher building at the very end.
Almost like the Kingpin season should come out.
Well,
I don't know if I could handle a whole season of Kingpin.
I think, as Kyle said in the Jessica Jones podcast, he's such a big criminal villain that he'll probably pop up
more all over Daredevil. The place.
Yeah. Well, yeah, at least the Defenders.
So he doesn't need his whole series. That'd be weird anyway. It's a villain.
I just love that whole choreographed like fight when the guards release all those other prisoners on the Punisher too.
That was a great scene. What do we think about the scene between Kingpin and Matt when Matt came down to the prison to confront him?
I would be scared.
That was a very good scene.
Beat him. Yeah.
It really was a very good scene.
What did you think about it, moderator?
I basically loved every time Vincent D'Onofrio was back on the screen, just like Spencer. I mean, he's so good in this character and so good in this role that every conversation he had, even with the minor supporting prisoner guys that were either randomly there because they were there, or the guards that he made kind of his little gang inside the prison.
Like, already?
Yes.
Well, I love when he's, like, yelling at the other guards and the other prisoners. He's like, try. Is that what you were saying?
I don't know.
Why are you laughing?
I like the way that they portrayed him when he first got to prison, as if he was scheming, but kind of weakened. But he wasn't weakened at all. He was just waiting for his moment, and then he used the Punisher as a pawn to just do what he needed to be done. Well, and he showed the respect for the Punisher in the end, too.
Yeah.
He did.
By releasing him into the wild.
And also, like, I love the fact that, because he, in the comics, though, Kingpin's always, like, three steps ahead of everybody else. Like, yeah, he could have had the guards let him out, but then he knows he'd just be a fugitive, and that doesn't get him what he wants. He wants his position back. He wants people to, you know, think he's innocent and that he is this, you know, benevolent businessman. And so he's playing his long game of proving he's innocent and getting out.
It's interesting, and actually I'm going to segue a little bit here, because what I did when I sent out the questions to the panelists was kind of cover some of the predictions that were made, much of which were Kyle's.
Surprise, surprise.
And one of the things that he had predicted was that Matt might be forced to protect Kingpin from the Punisher, when in fact Kingpin didn't need that protection. He just used the Punisher to his own end and then orchestrated his escape.
That may come down the
road.
May still come down the road.
That's just because
when Kingpin gets out, Punisher will probably be waiting.
Punisher said, next time we meet, I'm going to kill you. And then I love that moment because they both respect each other at this point, and Kingpin's like, I know.
So maybe your prediction is just a season ahead of when it's going to happen.
Maybe so.
Actually, we have some build-up towards that confrontation, which I think is better than just getting that confrontation right off the bat.
Okay.
Yeah, like we don't need to get all the best things right out the gate.
I just went off the
pacing.
Prediction.
Pacing, Kristen.
Melvin Potter had a few more appearances. How'd you feel about that, Kyle?
Loved it. I love Melvin Potter. And
is he the suit guy?
Yes. And like, there's, because you, in the first you have it a couple times, and this one you get him more, but very friendship with Matt. And so, like, I know when he does become, when he snaps and becomes a villain, it's going to be really good. And you get a flash of his costume, because he lowers his shirt and shows Matt the armor he has underneath his shirt in an episode, and that's his gladiator costume.
And he actually makes a reference to it, too. I don't remember exactly what he says, but it was kind of an oblique.
There's a couple of them, because, like, when he's gladiator, he has buzz saws on his arms, and a couple times when he gets defensive, he picks it up. Mm-hmm. Like, you can see him.
Oh, yeah. See, again, not a comic book reader. I don't know these things.
I really liked when he gave Matt his new weapon, too.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, that was great.
Oh, that was so exciting.
That's the last,
And then freaking Electra, where's mine?
Where's mine?
He's like, ignore her.
He's like,
that's what I was thinking. So I'm like, who are you?
She's so sociopathic, spoiled brat.
And also for comic book fans, in the back, like, Daredevil's lamest villain is one of his first called Stilt Man. And he's a guy essentially in armor that all it does is make his legs 50 feet tall.
Wow.
And that's it.
The
dumbest villain ever.
Did they run out of ideas in the first armor? How do they really? Wow.
Well, yeah.
They were working up to it. So what do you hope to see? What do you wish for? Or what are your predictions for a third season.
Gosh, I'm just so excited. Like, I don't think we talked about our stars, but I'm like a five holy smokes kind of business.
Well, actually, we typically do the rating scale on a first look. But okay. If you want to re-rate it, we can go around and re-rate it.
Yeah. I mean, I'll at least do it for me. I mean, yeah, five holy smokes. I actually read a couple of reviews that said that some people felt that this season wasn't as strong as the first season. Right. And I was like, what?
Wrong.
I think a couple of people said maybe it focused too much on the action-y parts, but I don't think that's true. I thought it was pretty balanced all the way around.
It was very balanced.
It was very balanced.
Way more
yeah.
balanced than the first season.
So, yeah.
They probably watched the Affleck movie and just got confused.
But the fight scenes are so well choreographed.
Yeah.
It's not just...
And they're not all the same.
They were probably just being pretentious.
And
but...
they're perfectly interspersed in between. I mean, you had, to go back to the Stellar Graveyard scene, there was action, 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 and then they just kind of parked it and had a intellectual meeting of the minds.
Yeah.
And how much more balanced.
And they did that on the top
followed
of the roof
the
when they
episodes.
First...
Correct.
Yeah.
And, yeah. I mean, their whole... conversation back and forth when he has Matt chained up on the rooftop.
Oh, and since we're talking about action scenes, like, how great was it when he's fighting the Irish people, but at the same time, he has to stop the Punisher from killing the Irish people? Like, that choreography on that fight
yeah.
is so
oh,
yeah,
the camera work.
Yes!
All pointing down the
camera work was fantastic.
I'm
yeah,
not.
That staircase scene was,
it was
beautiful.
I really...
And I have to give hats off to the cameraman or to the cinematographer, whoever was in charge of this, because normally point of view shots in a
that
fight sequence
stairway.
Can make you sick.
Oh yeah,
yeah. They did.
But they did a great job. Like I was
well, they
like,
didn't,
oh cool.
They did it, but without doing shaky cam. Which, a lot of time you see it's shaky cam and it's really disorientating. They actually did steady cam on it and it makes a big difference.
Yes, it does.
And it added so much to the tension of those fight scenes because it was you could almost feel the closeness of the stairwell and the fact that he was up and then down and then.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, they're showing more and more like how strong Daredevil's combat skills are because he's pretty high up there. So that's pretty, it's exciting to watch. But yeah, going back to what I was saying, holy smokes, 5 stars.
I was already at a home.
I'm so excited to see more. All of it.
I think I ended season one with 4.5 stars, so, and I said season two was better, so I guess I'm a 5-star holy smokes too.
Oh, holy smokes.
You just wanted to do that.
Yeah.
Yeah,
that's like your Scooby-Doo moment, isn't it?
Yeah, 5 stars. I don't know about a holy smokes.
That's what 5 stars is. It's a holy smokes.
Oh, that's
it's a... like you have to watch every episode now.
Obsessive Mind makes me feel like that even with shows aren't that good. So this is a really good show. Better than season one. 5 stars?
You have to have stars. Remember we had that conversation.
Mm-hmm.
And the Jessica Jones
4.75.
No, 5 stars. Where's holy smokes?
Oh, holy smokes. Well, it's better than holy shit.
Yeah. Well, I think when we left off at season one, I think I was 2 or 2.5. I think once I was 2.5 once things were explained to me. Thank you, Kyle. And
you
so I
double up.
I'm not going to go quite to a 5 because even now, like even though I, you know, even though I knew the second season was supposedly better, it still took me 3 months to start watching it. So I'm going to say I'm at a 4, maybe a 4.5, just because I don't have to watch it right away when it comes out. Like other shows, like Jessica Jones, I needed to watch. Right away.
So it seems intriguing.
It's very intriguing.
There's still some possible pitfalls to you.
There could be. I'm nervous now that season 3 may be a pitfall. I'm cautiously optimistic that I won't be because season 2 was so great.
Why would season 3 be a pitfall?
I don't know. If they got the pacing mixed up or if they tried to do too much.
You're just worried they'll go back to what you didn't like about the first season.
Amen.
Yes. Did that help
but
you?
But what if they don't do it?
Then it'll be fine.
Okay.
Then it'll be maybe a holy smokes?
Then maybe. Maybe. Like I said, Daredevil, it took me a while to get into it. So I don't wanna jump to a 5 and then have it come crashing and burning next season.
You should just watch it with Kyle.
I tell you, another thing for me is when we get to... I'm not as curious about Daredevil season 3 as I am about Punisher season 1.
Yes.
Yeah.
I'm much more excited for Punisher Season 1 than I am for Daredevil Season 3.
Yeah.
But I think that's partly because the end of Daredevil Season 2 didn't leave me with any really juicy cliffhanger, except for the Punisher CD thing, which you've explained. And that leads back to Punisher.
Yeah.
So where do they go with it that will keep it as exciting as the first two seasons have been?
I can sort of get behind that, just because, like I said earlier, the... Hand versus Chase, Black Sky motif was confusing, whereas the Punisher stuff was strong. Like,
yeah.
It was just no question. The performances were on point. The fights were on point. The line delivery was on point. Everything in the prison was exceptional. So, yeah, I can kind of get behind that. But I'm at a 5.
Yeah.
I even posted on Facebook. I'm like, I'm totally a Daredevil fan now. I've come to the fold. Just because of this season. And I'm also excited for the Punisher first season. I'd like to see what they do with that. I hope that in the Punisher first season, maybe we get a casual cameo or something like that from Charlie Cox. Because I feel like they're the best when they're together.
Or
at least in scenes around each other.
That final scene between the two of them in this with... You know, him being overwatching with the sniper rifle was just brilliant.
It was.
Yeah.
It was. And the fact, I know, they're talking across the street, and he knows that he's got the hearing, so he's talking to him.
And he calls him Red.
Yeah. He calls him Red! Yeah!
I did like that too. There's an affectionate nickname. That was a good thing.
It's, like it's cute so little, cute. It's a cute little bromance.
So, but seriously, do you have any predictions for the third season of this? Which, it hasn't been announced yet, but it's probably going to happen.
I think Elektra's going to be revived and she'll make an appearance, whether it's she's becoming a major villain or if it's just a cameo here or there.
Yeah.
See, they ended on a very specific comic book note, so I know where they're going for the next season.
Right. Okay, let's talk about that after.
What if it's a longer cliffhanger? What if they left?
They've had hints of it in season one, and then that season two, the last three episodes are like launching right into it.
Interesting. So you know what's happening.
You're so skeptical.
One of us has to be.
It would be stunning if they didn't do a season 3 of Daredevil.
It'd be very,
yes.
I think they're cautious on renewal because they plan so much now.
Yeah, they have a lot.
Like, when are they
going to
film it?
Could be in the Defenders.
In addition to their film series, I mean, their whole division is on overdrive right now.
Mm-hmm.
And they really want Charlie Cox in Infinity War.
They really want Charlie Cox.
Yeah, they want pretty much every Marvel hero they can get in.
They're trying to force me to watch all those other Marvel movies.
They're so good, though.
They are so good.
I know, but I've seen them all. It's okay. You can do it, too. It's not that hard.
Captain America is really important.
It's really good, too.
I'm just saying.
Very good.
Like, there's just other important characters to the universe.
For the listeners, please note that Hilary is currently wearing a Captain America t-shirt.
She is. She does.
It's true.
Were there any other Easter eggs that we missed somehow, Kyle?
There are a lot, but there are a lot more obscure Daredevil plot lines and storylines.
Did Bullseye appear again and we didn't see him?
But I have a feeling that Matt confronting Fisk in prison and really making it personal, I think that's what's going to get... Because, you know, Bullseye is always connected to Fisk. He's always his top assassin. And I think that Matt made it personal and brought Fisk's wife into it, or fiancé. They haven't gotten married yet.
I do hope to see Bullseye in season 3.
But yeah, I have a feeling that was the line. Because, I mean, also when he's hitting him, Matt tries to fight back, and I think Fisk will pretty much knows that he's Daredevil just from that one interaction.
So scary.
I'm predicting a Bullseye appearance.
Kingpin scares me.
Because they have Kingpin, they did the Punisher. I mean, I feel like it's the next logical progression as far as well-known Daredevil people.
Yeah.
So unless they make season 3 all about the chase versus the hand, it would line up.
I have a feeling they would do it because this season was so well, like split storylines. Like, you know, do what they did, like 3 episode Punisher arc and then some hand arc and then combine them.
Why do you think they would do a Punisher arc?
No, I'm saying that's how they did this season.
Oh,
it was really well received.
Yeah, using the formula.
So I feel like in season 3 they're going to kind of use the same formula of doing like a couple arcs.
And I actually don't want them to go full tilt into hand chased stuff in the third season. Not unless they give non-comic book readers a whole bunch more foundational information. Because anything that I know about it, I'm learning from you on these podcasts. Not from the show. So I think that needs to happen.
Hand felt so Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle to me.
Who?
Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles.
There's a reason. The turtles are obsessed with Daredevil. In the original comic, Matt is carrying the turtles when he gets hit by a car. And the radiation that goes in his eyes is what turns them into the turtles.
Oh my goodness gracious.
Stick. They named Splinter after Stick.
Gotcha.
Everything in Ninja Turtles is based on Daredevil.
Yeah.
It's well, there we go. It's the hand, it's the foot clan.
I'm shocked.
Instead of the hand, it's the foot.
Yeah.
Electra does have the same weapons as Raphael.
Yeah.
So that's something like this.
Mind blown. Okay.
What do we think that Defenders will come before or after season 3 of Daredevil?
I think it'll come
before.
Okay.
Yeah.
So we've got a long time to wait for Daredevil season 3 then.
Yeah.
I mean,
like,
I think
it's guaranteed. I just think they don't know where they're going
to
fit it in.
Yeah, I think they're going to try to make it next year, but
they're
going
to have to, otherwise you'll get fans will get a little irate if you go 18 months now between the seasons.
Yeah.
I don't want to wait.
But it's not like you won't have Daredevil.
Helping
like,
Defenders.
Right.
Yeah. So maybe they'll forego season 3 and go to Defenders. Who knows?
I don't forego it.
Yeah, don't do that. No.
I love both shows, but after season 2, I love Daredevil the best of the two so far, and I would rather see a season 3.
I would rather see a season 3.
And I love David Tennant. I'm in the David Tennant wife colony. Sister wife colony. Whatever we call it.
Creepy is what I'm calling it.
David, we love you.
Call me.
Edit point.
No! We gotta bring it to other people.
She needs to hear this.
David, if you'd like to appear on Couch Potato Tonight, please send us an email.
Only if you wear the proper suit. People.
I'm Kylie's people.
But the point is, I could choose between the two. I would rather have a third season of Daredevil than a second season of Jessica Jones.
Me too.
That's the way
actually.
I feel about it. Is there anything else that we haven't covered or that you want to cover regarding Daredevil season 2, The Punisher, Elektra, Kingpin, or any of the things we've discussed, or predictions?
Dear writers, please don't let me down and make me hate season 3.
Put the owl guy in it.
Didn't he die?
No, he has a son who has powers and is an actual main villain.
He's the owl guy.
I think that's his
official
name.
Yeah, the owl.
Okay.
The Marvel's version of the Penguin.
Oh.
I see.
It's also similar.
Any other things? Thoughts? Comments?
Charlie Cox, keep doing what you're doing.
Yeah.
Except
when agreed.
You audition for other roles.
Yeah.
Remember to look people in the eye when you're not playing Daredevil.
Casting people, keep doing what you're doing. You've done
casting
job.
Writers, keep doing what you're doing.
Big props to the producers, the casting directors, the writers.
Everybody who brings it from
team.
Everyone.
It's amazing. It's movie quality television.
Costuming is fantastic.
Yeah,
yes.
It looks
locations
so real.
Locations are brilliant.
It's better than some of the movies, I think.
It is.
Than some of them, yeah.
Not Captain America, obviously, right, Hilary?
They're kind of even.
Okay.
They're even.
He's also married to the Daredevil super fan. I don't know.
I mean, well, he's also a big Captain America fan, though, too. So that's part of what, you know.
Makes you work.
Yeah.
That's the secret to him, right there.
That's the secret to their very happy marriage.
We balance each other.
Yeah.
So are you going to keep watching, provided the show comes out?
Season
3?
Yeah, I
guess so.
Kristen begrudges, but agrees.
Agrees.
All right. Well, with that said then, I would like to thank Kyle, Hilary, Spencer, Nick, and Kristen for joining me once again on our Marvel's Defenders series to talk about Daredevil Season 2. The next time this panel reconvenes will most likely be after the Luke Cage series is released, which is planned for September 30th on Netflix. So we will probably talk about it within 2 to 3 months of when that is released, just because we have to have time to process. In the meantime, we have several other new episodes coming down the pike. As I said in the introduction, we have revisits, we have new panels, we have other superhero panels. It's not just Marvel around here, but we do a lot of Marvel too. We also do DC. So if you like them, we're equal opportunity. Keep listening to us. Follow us on the blog at couchpotatosunite.wordpress.com. Like us on Facebook. Follow us on Twitter, YouTube, Stitcher Radio, subscribe, email us if you'd like, let us know if we're doing good things or bad things. We're open to whatever feedback you might have. Until that time, keep listening, keep watching, stay tuned. Bye-bye.